So a very good afternoon, everyone. A warm welcome to our esteemed panelists. We are very pleased and honored to have each one of you here, sir. A warm welcome to the principals, faculty, students, and all the participants who are in the webinar today. My name is Sheba, and I am from TASC. Before we proceed, I'd just like to give a small brief introduction about TASC, who we are and what we do. So TASC is basically a non-profit organization created by the government of Telangana to provide quality services to the industry and bridge the gap between the industry and academia. We do it by partnering with various technology and skill partners who offer industry-specific learning modules at a subsidized cost and sometimes at no cost. These modules, in turn, are given as service offerings to the TASC registered students from TASC registered colleges throughout the state of Telangana. Students are skilled and certified further, and we have actually a placement team sitting in our office who are constantly in touch with the corporates, and corporates in turn will have access to the pool of the trained students who have acquired one or more skills much before they are out of the college and they are placed in their respective organizations. Apart from this, we have other programs such as finishing schools that cater to the students who have passed out and are jobless basically. And we have programs such as entrepreneurship programs, life skills, communication skills, soft skills, and so on and so forth. During this pandemic, we have organized a series of webinars to the students and colleges so that they can have a clear picture and clear their misconceptions hearing from the experts themselves. Today's webinar, Expectations of Animation, Visual Effects, Gaming and Comics Industry Post-COVID-19 is the 14th one in its row. The areas in our topic, animation, visual effects, gaming, comics, all these actually take us back to the time when we enjoyed them the most, and I'm sure we are all as the same thrill even today. And movies like Bahubali and Avatar, with all these effects, make a lot of crores of money, and many such movies for that matter. So though there is a lot of scope in this industry, students always see it, don't see it as a career option. For this, I think one of the reasons that can be for this is these areas of learning are not included in the curriculum. They are not part of the academic curriculum. They are learned out of interest and passion of the students or a particular individual. So today, the point I want to make is, if you have any questions, the college fraternity, the student community, any participant, if you have any question regarding this industry, this particular industry, this is the forum where you can ask your questions, post your questions. I bet you if your questions are not answered here, they will not be answered anywhere else, because such is the expertise of each and every panelist that we have today in our midst. Also, towards the end of the webinar, we have our keynote speaker, Sri Jayesh Ranjan, IAS, Principal Secretary, Department of IT-ENC, Industries and Commerce, Government of Telangana. So he would be giving his keynote address at the end of the session. On that note, may I now welcome Sri Shrikant Sinha, CEO TASC, and request him to take over. Welcome, sir. Over to you.
Thank you very much, Sheba, and a very good afternoon to all the principals, faculty members, TPOs, and students who have joined this webinar. If I could ask all the speakers to be on the screen for a minute so that we can have a photo opportunity also. Mike, can you also join? And Sheba, can you also join and do the honors of taking the photograph also for everyone? And Winston Churchill said, an opportunity, a crisis is an opportunity not to be missed. And that's exactly what we are doing today by doing this webinar over here today. And also ensuring that we are able to communicate. And we have close to about 300 people who have joined in as of now, I'm being told by the admin. And we would like to use this opportunity to help people understand as to what are the opportunities. Today, during COVID, we are talking about contact-free economy, contactless economy. And everything is happening, and it's called as a, what we call as homebound economy. everything needs to be delivered at home itself, including entertainment. And that is really where we said, let's start looking at how this industry is shaping up, what's happening in this industry. And I think instead of me talking about this industry, we have an esteemed panel with us today, people from, and we have put together a panel which is covering each and every aspect of the animation, visual effects, gaming, and comics industry itself. And if I'm permitted to use the word, and I'll not be wrong in using the word, we are the doyens of the industry sitting with us today. People who have created this industry, who have nurtured this industry, and brought it to a level where it is today. And as I introduce them, you would be getting to know them better. I will start by introducing the guru, the dada, the champion of the industry itself, Mr. Biren Ghosh, Vice Chairman, CII, National Media and Entertainment Committee of CII, and he's also the country head for Technicolor India. Technicolor India is a 103-year-old arts and science pioneer, and he is heading that. He's also, as I said, the Vice Chairman for the National Media Entertainment Committee and a FICCI committee member on Animation and Visual Effects Forum. He has got substantial experience as a futurist and a strategist, and has evangelized the Indian creative technology industry in animation and VFX globally. Prior to this, he has worked with Eros International at the ED, at Kahani World Incorporated as CEO and President, at Animation Bridge and DoTV Interactive as CEO as well as COO. I think this is the first time, friends, that we have an Emmy Award winner, because Biren has received 8 Emmy Awards, 4 National Academy Awards to his credit, apart from a clutch of other awards like the Golden Lion at Cannes as well as the BAFTA Awards. Welcome, Biren. It is a pleasure having you with us. Next, I move on to Rajiv Chilaka, Founder and Managing Director, Green Gold Animation Private Limited. Rajiv leads a team of about 800 artists who have produced over 10 shows, 700 episodes, 80-plus TV movies, and 4 feature films. But his claim to fame is none other than the mighty Little Bheem, Chota Bheem. As all of us and people, I'm sure all of you would have seen that. Under his leadership, Green Gold Animation has won many accolades and achieved many a milestone. Green Gold's group footprint spans across television, movies, digital, LNM, reaching an audience of about 60 million kids globally. Wow. That's some kind of a footprint. An alumni of Academy of Arts, San Francisco, USA, and he also holds a Master's of Science in Computers and Telecommunications from the University of Missouri. Welcome, Rajiv. Moving on to our third eminent panelist, Mr. Madhava Reddy Yatam, or Mike. Mike, can we get you on screen, please? I think Mike is shy of showing himself, only he wants his work to speak. Anyway, he's the founder and CEO of Rotomaker, and which is one of the largest VFX post-production facilities in India. This group has an academy which provides courses to on VFX and more. He's the director of technical services for VFX Hollywood. Previously, he's worked very closely with Biren, in Technicolor, the digital technical technician, Sony Pictures Entertainment, Deluxe Entertainment, Digital Entertainment, as well as Rainmaker. And he has also been instrumental in working as a senior robot scoping and film scan test record and Crest Communications. So he holds a PG diploma and animation diploma in animation and visual effects. So while Mike, we are not able to see you, we welcome you. Moving on to the next eminent speaker, Mr. Rajesh Arthurakia, And he's the founder, director, and mentor, Framebox Academy 2.0 Academy. I'd like to know later on why it's 2.0. This is, of course, one of the premier academy for media and creative arts. The institute, headed by him, has trained over more than 100,000 students over a span of the last two decades. He has initiated international tie-ups with Cambridge University, Anglia Ruskin University from UK, Sikkim Manipal University, as well as Sensei University from Canada. I hope I got that name right. He has engaged with a lot of internationally acclaimed animators such as Steve Wright to design a curriculum and new path-breaking software over here. He has been part of several industry bodies and has been a speaker in many international and national forums across. So welcome, Rajesh. And last but not the least, our own Amarnath Reddy, who was my predecessor. He joined the Andhra Pradesh Society for Knowledge Networks, which is also called as IEG and now called as TASC, in 2006, and was the executive director and then became the CEO in 2007. He took over as the chief relations officer in ITEC department once the bifurcation happened in 2015. And as of date, he has seen a lot of investments as well as jobs coming in the IT, ITES sector, R&D, engineering, animation, gaming vertical. He has been instrumental in that, and he is also responsible for developing new clusters in and around the city of Hyderabad. Previously, he's worked for over 15 years in United States in various capacities, including industries across automotive, insurance, finance, advertising, marketing, research, manufacturing, a certified professional trainer, as well as he is the general secretary for MLR GSET Table Tennis Academy, which has two players represented India in table tennis and several players representing state of Telangana. So, of course, as far as we look at it, he is an amateur astronomer. Interesting. And he has completed his BTech from NIT Warangal, as well as MS from Southern California, Los Angeles. And he was the CIO and has also done a CIO training from IIM Ahmedabad. So as you can see, we have got a very, very interesting panel with us today. And thanks for switching on your camera, Mike. So without any further ado, let me move on to and start the proceedings, because we really have quite some short time. So I'll request all the panelists to keep their starting comments just for about 5 minutes. So let me start by asking you, Biren, how the industry has been impacted by COVID. And if you could do some crystal ball gazing and help us understand where is the industry moving now. Over to you. Biren, you're mute.
Thank you very much. Pleasure to be here and participate in what I think is the most important agenda, which is speaking to young people and talking about the future. I must start by just saying that in my introduction, there were many things and awards that were attributed to me. And I can tell you that that this took hundreds of people, thousands of people to achieve that. Our industry is a team sport. Cricket can be played with 11 people, but no animation movie or visual effects movie can be made with 11 people. So it's really an accolade to the 4,500 young people that I'm surrounded by. And also I must also say that, you know, great to be on a panel with such wonderful people. You know, the future is about making connections. So while Amarnath has been involved with creating two table tennis champions, Rajesh, who's further down on the screen, was the largest producer of table tennis balls at one time. Now you need to know these facts and put them together in order to weave a story. And if you can do that, That is animation, that is storytelling, and that is the future. Okay, and you're going to hear from some of the absolute champions like, you know, Rajiv, who probably wakes up in the morning and thinks of a new story for breakfast. So all that is coming out in a short time. And Mike, of course, you know, I didn't want him to feel lonely, so I put on a cap as well. So, you know, great panel. And Shrikant, you know, you are a bit overdressed for an animation panel, but I think it's part of the call of duty. So great to be here. I'd like to start by saying that I have only one worry about COVID-19. And my worry is this. I have not seen anyone in any industry that has actually been put under the water by COVID. Yes, there are losses. Yes, there is interruption of work. Yes, there are huge issues for airlines and hospitality and every industry, including ours. But people have never been so efficient. People's reflexes have never been so sharp. People have never controlled their cost. And people have never done so much innovation as has happened in the last 150 days. And my worry is that when we have a solution to this problem, people will be relaxing and getting inertia and going back to old ways of doing things, which will be your quote your Churchill story, that will be a real tragedy. Because we have learned so much in 150 days. I'm quite sure that people on this call, if you took the average age, will be less than 21 or 22 amongst the 300, 500 people and more joining. But none of these young people, and potentially even their parents, have not faced a crisis. The parents of my generation, you know, have seen world wars. They've seen lots of things that have happened. And this actually is what I wanted to start with by saying that opportunity is what you create at that moment in time. And specifically, as far as our industry is concerned, there are many moving parts. I'll come to this in more detail later. But all I can tell you is that as far as CG animation is concerned, or the production of animation is concerned, and animation that is not dependent on live action shooting, this has increased tremendously. And we have had a tremendous patience. I'm sure those who are original creators like Rajiv have found that their clients, their broadcasters, and so on and so forth have been extremely patient and understanding, because they're facing the same problem. It's not a problem on one side and not the other side. And similarly, we produce about 6 or 7 series at a time for DreamWorks and Nickelodeon and Walt Disney every day for many, many years now. And they've been extremely understanding. And our team, actually, we are in the process of hiring about 480 to 500 people over the next 5 months. And in that field, we did not have any reduction. On the flip side, we are also very involved with visual effects, as is Mike here and others. And we know that when there is no live action shooting, there is no work that comes into a visual effects studio to be done. The pandemic came so quickly on us that we had work that had to be completed. And I think India has shown an exemplary dedication and work ethic in being able to, you know, deliver that as soon as there have been small windows of opportunity and things are opening again. As far as the games industry is concerned, this is the absolute shining story, because games has never seen a growth worldwide and in India to the extent that it has seen from a consumer point of view during this period of time, because people are at home and they have the ability to switch off and immerse themselves into playing games and things like that. And there are two segments that didn't play too many games. One of them was women. They are not as much in the gaming story as others. And there's been a dramatic growth of that. So any of you who follow the BARC ratings on TV and television and what's happening in households will know from Sunil Lulla, who is their CEO, and others, they do webinars every week, that you've seen kids' channels show an increase, you've seen movies show an increase. People were watching a lot of television before, episodic television, but movies, people didn't have the time to see it, but the movie channels found a big increase, and gaming found a fantastic increase. So, irrespective of COVID, I just want to end this first question of yours by saying that in the last 10 to 15 years, if you look at the growth rate of this industry, animation, visual effects, games, and comics, you will see that the growth rate has been a very high double digit. We have normally grown at double the growth rate for overall all industries in the country. And we have helped to drive the overall entertainment and media growth rate, because we used to be around 2 to 3% of the whole industry when I came very recently into this industry about 22 years back, which was kind of the beginning of the story. Okay. I was already then an old man, so I'm not asking you to take any guesses right now. And all I want to say is that we have seen a compound annual growth rate in media and entertainment of between 12 to 14%. And in animation, visual effects, and particularly games, which is newer, it has always been much higher than that. We are limited, however, in our growth rate. We are limited in our growth rate by the production-ready talent which is available in the country. Because most people who have production houses and studios and so on and so forth could have grown faster in these last 10 or 15 years had they found more talent that was production-ready. And I'm very happy that we have Rajesh on this panel, because Rajesh, for about 10 years or more, used to be also running a studio where he used to make demands on the people that are in, he was also involved in training. So he is able to see both sides of this. You know, he's what I call a classic double agent, right? He's been on both sides of the table, and he knows that this argument can only be solved by technology and by doing things that I think Telangana is so ably recognizing and doing in the journey that TASC has taken upon itself. So I would say that the slogan, Srikanth, for you is, whether you talk of COVID or you talk of the problems of production talent or you talk of anything that we need, focus not on the task. Focus on the task, not the fear of the task. So this is a nice slogan. Maybe you want to put it below your logo, right? Focus on the task, not the fear of the task. People today who are studying, most people from that we have on this call, you know, they are worried about their future. Their parents are worried about the future. That means they have a fear of the task. They're not focusing on the task. So hopefully right. This panel will bring that focus to them, saying, this is what the industry is saying that we need. This is where we should go. Let's forget about whether we'll get jobs or no jobs. I'll come to that portion later on in my conversation, maybe with everybody. Okay. But I do feel that we have to understand that this industry is not just about entertainment. If you learn the skills that we learn today, whether you are developing the next Airbus, whether you are developing a vaccine for COVID, or whether you are doing whatever else, what is animation? Animation is imagery, and animation is simulation. And no matter what you do today, any field, any industry, you're seeing more and more video, you're seeing more and more real-time moving images, and those require these skills. So while we are talking today on our particular sector, I just wanted to make the point that our sector doesn't have a box that we have to put people into, and they can really go into any dimension, right? So Kota Bheem might find the next COVID vaccine, don't be surprised, if Ravji puts his mind to it, or may design the next Airbus. When the Airbus has to be brought to life, then Rajesh will provide the people, and Mike will, in his studio, be able to create all the effects for it. So that is my initial conversation with you.
Fantastic. Great, Biren. Excellent. So you have played the role of Krishnamachari Srikanth opening the innings. Interesting, very interesting, and great points from your side. And definitely appreciate it. Now, I've been told by the administrator that there are 618 people who have joined us. Fantastic. As of now, and more are still to join. So I'll request all of them to please quickly put down your questions in the question box, because once we finish our discussions, we will take up your questions. So please put your questions over there. So since Chota Bheem was discussed, so Rajiv, let me move on to you next. How has COVID impacted Chota Bheem, and what future does Chota Bheem look at? Rajiv, you are muted.
Okay, hi. So thanks for having me. And it's always difficult to talk after Biren, because he's one of the most dynamic speakers. I think he should be in Hollywood and talking and acting and stuff. I mean, he makes everyone look so weak and meek. But anyway, I admire you, Biren, and that was a great, talk. So for our studio also, initially, it was a very tricky scenario when COVID came by, and suddenly we had a day or two to plan to figure out how do we figure out this thing. And with in animation, of course, you know that the computer hardware is pretty solid, so not many people had computers at home. So we had to figure out a way where our IT had to play a bigger role than normal, and we had to figure out a way how do we get these computers to the artist's home and restart. So the first 10 days, I think we all were in kind of enjoying the whole COVID scenario. Everybody at home, the family, wives are happy, kids are happy, parents are happy. And then came then realization that, oh my God, what is going on? And that's when the seriousness took over. And then we realized we have to get onto the production. And so the first 1 month, the productivity was not so great, 40%, 50% what we could do. And slowly, right now, even now, we are working from home, but we are back to producing about 100% of productivity. And all of us are pretty much working from home, except for some people like me who are crazy to continue working from office. But like Biren mentioned earlier, this has been one of the most fruitful, creatively fruitful times for myself, the company, and our creative teams and all, because this has given us lot of peace to rethink our company strategy. Earlier, we were making business plans for, let's say, the next 6 months or the next 1 year at best, and we never looked beyond that. And now we started planning till 2025. Just today we closed a contract with our partner Turner and extended our 4-year contract with them on Chota Bheem. You asked about Chota Bheem. So till 2024, we have signed, which means it's good news for Hyderabad and Task, because we would need to employ more people because we have signed next 4 years of 2D animation series. Same time, while there is a 9-year-old Bheem who's conquering, continuing to keep the Indian hearts alive, there is this baby version of Bheem called as Mighty Little Bheem. He's also raising Indian flag high across the globes in 190 countries on Netflix. So it is India's first Netflix original for kids, and I'm very proud to say that it is from Hyderabad and Telangana, because before that no one has created a show from India that has gone on to become a global success. More importantly, it became the number one preschool show globally on Netflix, and the number two family and kids show on Netflix, second only to Boss Baby of DreamWorks. I mean, imagine now we are number two to DreamWorks. It's a dream come true for us. I mean, just to be heard. And people call me and tell us that the quality of Mighty Little Bheem is better than Boss Baby. And I feel very proud. We are not going to take that seriously, because probably we know that we still have a long way to go. And we're keeping ourselves grounded. But more importantly, what it proves is that this show was created locally for the global audience. So we have used writers from India, we have used artists from India, we have used storyboard artists, all kinds of artists from India. So which means that India is now ready for the world. And this is not just worked in for Indian audiences abroad, but it's worked for people from Latin America to Europe to the ASEAN countries, to India, to Americas. So it's been a wonderful journey for us. So Mighty Little Bheem continues to grow. We just delivered Netflix in the lockdown period, the third season of Mighty Little Bheem. And we are currently working on some specials for them. So we are very excited, and we are hoping for one more season of Mighty Little Bheem next year from them. So it's very exciting. And then last but not the least, the last 4 months, we have created about 6 new IPs. And the last 6 years, we have created only 3 IPs, which were new. So I feel very good that this time we have used effectively, and we've been able to create 6 new IPs, out of which I think we are close to selling two of them. I think I will have a contract ready by the end of this quarter. And so very exciting times for us. And also, we've been chanced to explore new softwares which are needed for the production, including game engine based softwares or Blender, or game engine softwares like Unreal or Unity. So we've been able to experiment. This has been a great time for us to experiment. And also at this point, I would like to thank the Netflix, team of Netflix, team of Turner for supporting us financially, that we went through all this period. We paid each and every artist of ours. We were able to employ them and retain them, which was very important for us. I know certain industries have been badly affected, but we were able to keep our head above water. We kind of crossed this crisis. I hope the crisis, the worst part is over, and the great things are ahead of us. I think in the interest of time, that's it from me.
Great. Thanks, Rajeev. Interesting, and congratulations on becoming the second in the world. Interesting. Very, very, very good. And Biren and Rajeev, it's music to my ears when you say you have got job openings available. So hope everyone speaks the same language. So Mike, I move on to you, hoping to hear the same language. So if you could do, tell us about, how it's impacted you and what could be the future for visual effects, especially.
Yeah, thanks for me. Thanks for being there, for me to give opportunity to be in the panel. COVID has affected for the visual effects industry definitely compared to animation and gaming, because visual effects is more dependent on the shootings. So most of the shootings are not happening. So that's why COVID has got affected more. So, but in future, we are going to have good job opportunities. More projects are going to come, because we have been hearing from our clients from Hollywood. They said, once the shootings start, you're going to get double the work, whatever, because the entertainment industry is something, there's a lot of new content required, because most of the content on the internet or whatever is happening is consumed during this COVID time. Most of the people have seen. So a lot of people are waiting for the new content. So definitely there's a great opportunity for new visual effects movies coming up. So they said, most of the companies have said, don't worry, once the COVID star shooting happens, you're going to get a lot of work. And definitely the artists, we are able to manage to do some work. We can't give much work to work from home. Only some important people were given with the security things, where the client is okay. But 70 to 80% of our facilities are shut down. It has impacted us definitely because of the COVID. Hopefully, probably in September, October, slowly it might pick up. Since last week we have seen some change. Generally, in August it picks up. So last week we have seen some change in the visual effects. Slowly, some shots are coming. Hopefully, I think things are going to be good by next year. From January, but there will be definitely a shortage of employment, because the next year we're going to get a lot of projects. But definitely there's going to be manpower shortage, because last year and this year, whole year, we didn't have many students training. So that is going to give an impact for the next coming years. So we should focus more on training. Definitely there's a good future for the students who are there here. They don't have to disappoint, they can still join the courses and be confident to get, jobs, So let's see how it goes. Yeah, that's all I can say from the visual effects part. Yeah.
Thanks, Mike. I was thinking that, because all the good places and the things in, in Sweden, etc., are not available. So everyone will be asking you to create those visual effects online and try to incorporate that. But yes, you need skills for that. And you rightly said, we at Task also want this year to be not a lockdown year, but a year where you build your skills. So moving on to you, Rajesh, since you ran a studio and you're into the skilling, So probably if you could tell me about the skilling part of it, how it has been going and what could be the future of, because if we look at technologies like AI, VR, AR, etc., coupled with animation, etc., I think the whole world can change, right? Whatever we saw in Star Wars or the Star Trek series, etc., is actually happening now. And that can only further be accelerated. So over to you, Rajesh.
Yeah, good afternoon, and thank you for having me on this panel. I am really honored to be with this great doyens of the industry, especially my friend, old friend, Biren, and I mean old. So coming to the situation today, we actually were in lockdown 15 days before everybody else went into lockdown. Students in Pune and Bombay were advised not to attend classes by the government. Earlier, and we thought, looking at the China situation, that this may continue for a few months, and that's why we actually transferred our machines to our faculty's houses. And in the time that we had, we did some trials and we got their internet working properly. And by first week of April, we had got all the hiccups over and we got the digital classes started, online classes started. So since then, we have been online and the classes have not been interrupted, luckily for us. And situation is such that the first time parents and students are accepting the online education. Otherwise, they always wanted a contact program and they wanted to see what our infrastructure looks like and how much our infrastructure is important. Now they've realized that these kids are sitting at home, they're learning well, they're in a safe environment, they're not wasting their time. If they miss something, they get my recorded sessions that they can go back to. So overall, this situation has put a new kind of scenario for us and for the parents that yes, their children can learn online and they will get a good education. And we have done a lot of counseling sessions also, and a lot of students, you'd be surprised, have been enrolling also for the programs. For the future, yes, which will be in contact, but right now they are starting with the online. So first of all, is music to my ears. All three panelists before me said there are a lot of jobs and a lot of opportunities, so the students don't have to worry and I don't have to worry about getting them placed. We have to just make sure that they learn all the new technologies. And why Framebox 2.0, you were going to ask me that. And it is because we revamped our entire curriculum just 2 years ago. We went and met 20 studios and asked them what they actually wanted. So things now, maybe a 3.0 is time to come with the COVID situation. And we are looking at Unreal, Unity, Blender, and all these kind of new technologies that are coming in, in shootings for virtual production. All these things are happening, so we have to try and prepare the students to be industry ready. So we make sure that they have a little lag time only before they get absorbed into the pipeline of a studio. So basically, COVID has been an opportunity for us, in fact, that we have been able to find a new way of training, and now we are getting the best trainers to train all across the country online. We are getting on webinars. We are getting, like I told you, that one webinar, we got 30,000 viewership, which would any seminar that I would do, I would not have more than 400-500, hall capacity is more than 700 in Mumbai. So it's like, these things, so many people are availing the opportunity and, coming on the webinars, getting the lessons online and learning from the best in the industry because of this. So this is what has helped us quite a bit, in my opinion. Yes. There is definitely a lag of that, some contact program should be there. And that's what I feel will happen once this COVID thing goes away. We will continue our contact program. But the acceptability of online has come only because of COVID. Otherwise, earlier people did not like the online program. They would want something very, very much in the classrooms. So this is what been for a real opportunity for us, actually.
Fantastic. Yeah, I still remember those days when in the Middle East I was starting the multimedia centers for another brand, and we used to talk about Maya and how much was the system going to cost. And right. Being into virtual education for 2.5 decades now, this is absolutely music to my ears that people are going online and it is acceptable both by parents and students. So now moving on to you, Amar. Since you had the ecosystem over here and a lot of organizations are there like Rajiv's organization, etc., and Mike's also and others. So what have you been hearing about the impact, on the industry of COVID? And if you could also do some crystal ball gazing and talk about future that you see for this industry, Amar, over to you.
Thanks, Srikant. It's been all positive. Okay. So, I mean, I hope that's a good word to say now. I mean, I've been speaking to people like Mike or Rajiv, my Hyderabad mates here, and, you know, getting different versions. But I think if you put it all together, it's been all positive. There's been a little effect on the VFX side of things. But by and large, I mean, it doesn't look like it is going to be a long-term thing. There's actually plenty of opportunities. I mean, I would like to list some four or five different points where I see a lot of positivity. First thing, you look at the Media and Entertainment Skill Council, Government of India, or National Skill Development Council, they have a mandate of training 11.74 lakh skill manpower by 2022 in animation and gaming. So even if you say 10 to 15% of that is Telangana's fair share, we would have to train some 1.5 to 2 lakh people just in the state of Telangana. So, I mean, that's a task for you, Srikant, right there. And, you know, if you see the priority that Government of Telangana has set for animation and gaming, you go to the heart of the Hyderabad, the high-tech city in Madhapur, Raidurg, we have three iconic buildings coming up. One for T-Hub, which is the nation's largest startup incubator. And another building for T-Works, which is a multidisciplinary prototyping lab, one of its kind. And the third one is Image Tower. And it's a very state-of-the-art facility. It's going to be an iconic building where we will get about 16 lakh square feet, out of which about 1.7 lakh square feet has been set aside for just the AVGC infrastructure. I mean, that includes studios, motion capture facilities, the green mat studios, editing labs, and all the good things in the animation and gaming sector. So that explains the importance of the animation and gaming that is there in the state of Telangana and in general as well. And if you look at the onset of Corona, Srikant, from March 25th, it's been 5 months. And a lot of these solutions in IT or anywhere emerge out of human problems, right? So since March 25th, if you look at the general landscape and ask people, or generally your sense of what people have been doing for the most part, most people have been watching movies, they've been on Netflix or Amazon Prime, or they've been onto online education, or you know, they'll be working from home. I mean, if you look at all these, the whole landscape, 90% of this involves animation, gaming, entertainment, right? So, I mean, the thing is here to stay. You know, that just explains that there is a lot of need for it. And if somebody says that entertainment is a luxury, I mean, they're terribly wrong. I think entertainment is a necessity, right? People are going to go mad. You know, if you take entertainment component out of people, they're going to go mad. Right. So you have to, from go back like thousands of years, entertainment has always been a necessity. And animation and gaming industry is there to stay. And there's a lot of government incentives, you know, like I was talking to you earlier, or I was explaining earlier about the Image Tower, an iconic tower. We have an STPI incubation facility, which is a humble start, but I mean, I think that is something also that we have. And we have a lot of policy and incentives that the government gives. I think there's a lot to be done in this sector. Lots of opportunities are there. And a lot of creative people, you know, I think they're naturally gravitated to this field. And I like the way how Biren started. You know, we run a very premier table tennis academy. Our principal secretary, Jayesh sir, is also... He's our chairman, and I'm proud to be the general secretary of it. And we have few people playing for the country, and some people representing the state. And Rajesh, you know, to my surprise, you know, this is the suspense that the creative people weave into conversations like this. I never knew that you know, he was into manufacturing table tennis balls. And I would like to drop another suspense here. Rajiv's daughter is my daughter's classmate. He doesn't know that. this is a suspense breaker for him. His daughter is an international tennis player, by the way. So here's my share of breaking the suspense here. So over to you, Srikanth. I'll chime in whenever necessary. But I'm glad that I'm part of this esteemed panel. Thank you.
Interesting. And thanks, Amar. While on table tennis, I used to represent my college and university in Delhi ages ago. So anyway, now I don't know if I can hold the bat also or not. But yeah, that's there. So Amar, as they say, might is right, or whoever has the mic gets the right to next. So why don't you tell us about, you were talking about Image Tower, you were talking about some of the incentive policies, etc. So why don't you tell us more about it, and also help understand that how is the infrastructure that is being looked at also going to help the students from tier 2, tier 3 towns and cities, and what kind of opportunities it will open up for the youth in the state?
Certainly, Srikanth, see this Image Tower, it's a 16 lakh square feet state-of-the-art tower that we are building, and Salar Puria is our partner in this. Out of which we are, the thing about animation, I don't want to speak when some eminent personalities are there, and at a risk of exposing myself, I'm still putting this across. When a company comes into animation, I think the biggest roadblock is the expensive softwares and application softwares that you have to procure or you have to use. But with an animation tower or image tower in place, if you can bring all those facilities and make them available to all these companies who have a threshold, who have to break this threshold in order to go to a certain level. I mean, they have the core competence, but they don't have the capital to invest in all these things. They can go on a shared model. So we thought of setting all this AVGC, the infrastructure, not just the hardware, but all the studios, the motion capture studios, the green mat studios, the suites, the editing labs, the data management labs, the dubbing suites, and all kinds of application softwares, whatever. I think Rajiv and Mike and all these people are like way ahead in the game. I mean, they could have it for themselves, but there is a lot of other people who want to get into this. So we want to set that. And we set aside 176,000 square feet just to establish these common infrastructure. And about 6,25,000 square feet of that is going to be set aside for the animation, visual effect, gaming, and cartooning companies. So that would accommodate about, let's say, roughly, give or take, 8,000 people. And this is going to be in the center of the city, all that space is going to be provided at a very affordable price. So that is one thing. Apart from that, I mean, there's a lot of fiscal incentives given by the government. So we give a lot of capital investment subsidy, reimbursement of production costs, lease rental subsidies, duty reimbursement, and so on. That could be a very boring thing for me to say in all these things, but there's a lot of benefit that a company, especially somebody in the medium segment, can derive out of these benefits. I mean, we have approximately 100 companies in Hyderabad with about 30,000, Rajiv or Mike, you can correct me if I'm wrong, about 30,000 people are working in the animation and gaming industry in Hyderabad, approximately, give or take. I think this is grossly not realizing the true potential of what animation and gaming can do. Some of it may have to do with lack of human resources or an opportunity in creating a larger amount of talent pool in this area where companies can grow. And to your point, Srikanth, or to your question, what about tier 2 cities? Recently, we had a company called Aetherum. This guy had very creative and niche ideas and applications on the motion capture side of things. And he applied for a small bit of land, and we sent his application to Twaga. Twaga is a very active member. It is an industry body for animation and gaming in Hyderabad, and they have did some due diligence and they came back with the report saying we in fact invited him to set this up in Hyderabad, but the guy wants to go to Warangal to do this whole thing. That was pretty people actually ask for Hyderabad. Hyderabad is a tough thing to get because there's a lot of competition. We don't just give away resources, land, or whatever in Hyderabad. But this guy is very intent on going to Warangal. So I wanted to speak to him, and I called him. And I just questioned him, why do you want to go to Warangal? You know, I have a lot of attachment to Warangal because I studied in Warangal. I in fact want him to go to Warangal, but I was just seeing if this guy is really serious and he can survive in Warangal. And he's like, you know, no problem. You know, we need a few people, maybe like, you know, the top cream, you know, I can get that support from Hyderabad, but a lot of the stuff that I can do, what I want to do, I can do in Warangal. I think other speakers are more, have more depth in this to speak on this topic. But I think animation, when you say animation gaming, there's a whole spectrum of skills, right? From like a ninth class dropout till like a, you know, PhD candidate. And most of the low end spectrum can be found. I mean, I think tier two cities are a great way to find this. And especially when you have, you know, the T-Fiber project, you know, I think Srikanth, they're very close to where their office is. And these guys are laying broadband internet fiber to every village or every household in the state, right? So when that is not a hindrance or a roadblock, I mean, and for animation in gaming, what you need is a high speed, high bandwidth connection, right? So I think things are going to get simplified, and this boundary between tier one, tier two is going to probably get reduced.
Fantastic. Thanks, Samar. We will come back to you later on in case there are any students' questions, etc. So let me move to the person who has seen it all and seen the industry grow, and probably is the best person to talk about the skill gaps. So Biren, if you could help us understand what are the skill gaps that exist in the industry today, and also talk about the employment opportunities and the growth opportunities over the next 5 years. And because we have got, I'm told, more than close to about 800 people by now, what is being done for making this sector attractive, if it is not already attractive for freshers? You're muted, Biren.
Thanks for the question. For those who've joined me, 632948 is me. I'm actually Biren Ghosh. If you took the alphabets, don't try and, I know there are a lot of people here who are very good at maths. So they will say it's FCBIDH, but that's not my name. Back to the story. I think it's really important that I would like to, you know, Amar and others have actually created the big picture for what this industry is all about. But I'd like to bring it down to the level of most of the 800 people on this call. This is not an industry. If you want to be a pilot, you know exactly what you have to do. If you have to be a civil engineer who is going to work in an architectural firm to make sure that you design foundations, you know exactly what you have to do. If you have to join animation, you don't know what to do, because there is nothing. Animation is the umbrella word for a number of skill sets. VFX is an umbrella word for a number of skill sets. And games is even more complicated because you have the art as well as the programming for it. So I would like for every one of you who are aspiring to be in a storytelling industry, to be in the animation industry, to understand that there is, at the core of it, it is visualization. If you believe that you have a strong visual sense, and our minds and our visual senses are like muscles, they can be developed. You have to have some ability, of course. Then you need to identify three things to start off in the industry. A lot of people go in search of money or jobs and then work backwards to say, I'm going to learn to be a carpenter because there is that job, or you have something more esoteric than that. And I was reading a fantastic quote by somebody. Everybody knows Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, a very old friend of mine for the last 45 years. And she came out on a very interesting interview yesterday. And I found a quote in that interview. It happens coincidentally to be her father's birthday, who I knew very well. He was the head of UB, the United Breweries in Bangalore, going back for many, many years. And she says, my father told me, money is not something you buy favors with. It's something you use to make a difference with. I believe that. We want to make a difference. We want to help change this world for the better. So today, if we want to bring change in our country, no matter if it's the projects and the fantastic initiatives of the Telangana government, or whether it is at the school level, or it is behavioral change, or whatever, you need to create very visionary stories for that. And you need to understand the foundations of storytelling, the foundations of art, the foundations of it, even if you're going to be completely in a different skill set. And I think then it's the storytelling story. And I think, you know, when Rajiv was speaking about what he does, it is different from what the bulk of the industry does. Because like in the IT sector, where the services are predominant, but the product creation is actually still catching up. Similarly, in animation, and I am a little embarrassed to say that actually we produce all of Boss Baby, but it's okay. as long as Boss Baby is done here and Mighty Little Beam is done there, we have one and two in the world, you know, within this call. That's fantastic. But in the case of Boss Baby, we neither create the character, nor do we create the story, nor do we create the idea, nor do we have the voices, nor do we do a lot of the things. We do actually all of the production and make sure that it is done to the level of DreamWorks. So, you know, when we started off and, you know, Rajesh was in the industry at that time, we used to say, when can we make a movie, you know, like Pixar or DreamWorks? And I think this call is telling people that we are proud to say we do that. Now, when you create every single frame of animation or visual effects, there are more than 12 to 14 disciplines that go into it. And I'm not even starting with the storytelling. So actually, there's a huge opportunity in the future for, you know, the origination of stories. And I want maybe Rajiv to address that when he talks a little bit about what can happen in that first process, because it's a very valuable process and very underutilized in India at this moment. And you know, you need many Rajivs to bring out the potential of our country in global storytelling. And I think, you know, it always takes the first step to do that. And he's doing that at Green Gold. And there are other companies as well in India that have started doing that very well. But I would say that if you are going to create in models, it is akin to sculpting. And if you create textures, it is akin to painting. And the rig that you create inside this model, you know, is a bit of math and anatomy and various things. Animation is only one of the processes in all those 14 processes of animation. And they take only 10 to 15% of the effort of the entire animation project. Less if you are doing end-to-end, as I explained earlier. And then, you know, there are things that there's lighting, there is rendering, there are many processes in this which need to be aligned at the student level. You need to learn the basics, which is universal, but then you need to choose maybe an area of your expertise and become a real master at it. And there are lots of opportunities. For example, even if you studied in animation today, and you mastered modeling in 3D, which you require to create both the characters as well as the props, as well as the background, as well as everything else in it. You know what the future of modeling is? 3D printing. 3D printing is going to become a huge field. It is all about the same technology of learning to make the model. Because the toy that you produce or the industrial item that you produce will have the same technology in it. So I think we need to look at from a task perspective or from a Telangana perspective, from a skills perspective, there are these lots of these things when you put imagery and simulation and what are the skill sets and what are the tool sets, right, into a four box kind of a story. You will find that there are amazing cross sections that come out of it. And therefore, you know, of course, people have done what we do for many years, but they've gone to the industrial design side of it. Because manufacturing has been the predominant field in here for the last, you know, 50, 100 years. Whereas today, there is, in the process of learning, you know, in your undergrad, there is a turn in the road that can take you more into the imagery part of it, which is what we do. So that is the first thing I want to mention. The next 5 years, if you ask me or anybody on this call, how to prepare for 2020 in 2014 or 2015, we would have answered you as cleverly as we'll answer you today. But the technology changes in our industry happen every 1 to 3 years. And when Rajiv mentioned that he has now already embraced the new technologies of game engine technology, you know, experimenting with Unreal and Unity and the other things that he was talking about, this would not have been something we would have said in 2015. Of course, it was there. and it was being experimented with, but it was not ubiquitous. Whereas in my opening comments today, I told you that this technology is so ubiquitous, it's going to come into live action film and TV also. So the challenge for people like Mike and Rajesh, who are also developing skill sets for themselves and for the industry, is that they need to be very nimble in how they are preparing people with the basics. And people, it's a lifelong learning. So although I was called old, I can just tell you that I've been in this organization alone for about 11 and a half years. And during these 11 and a half years, we have had almost complete technology changes more than four times. This means that we have to do two things. All the things that Amar spoke about have to be done very carefully. And it's good that the government is doing that. It is right that the government is doing that. But the government cannot install mocap and then say we install mocap, because the mocap technology will change every 2 years. It's very, very expensive. And because it is so expensive, the government should do it. Because if it was something that was a big money-making project, then Rajesh would have done it by now. So there are certain things that need to be done, providing like roads, right? You don't go into building roads as a private enterprise for a short-term return. You don't do that. So effectively, I think what Image is doing is to create the infrastructure. But for the purpose of this conversation, which is about people who are on this call, the technology transformation is going to keep happening in our industry. The talent needs to keep upskilling themselves. It's not about the freshers. Everyone that's worked more than 7 years in Mike's company or my company or Rajiv's company will also have to upskill themselves in the new technologies as much as the freshers. They are also freshers. So age doesn't matter. And I think the question of 5 years is really important, because you need to keep a very keen eye on what production will do in the next 2 to 3 years' time. And I love the new education policy for this reason, that it is breaking up into greater compartments. There are many skill sets which are available from our industry, which can actually be of tremendous opportunity to people who only done 5+3. A person 5+3 can do 2 or 3 of our skill sets with the same excellence as a person who is going to finish his graduation. And he or she can start earning some money. You know, Mike will take them to do some rotoscopy, etc., etc. Of course, the Telangana government has to make sure that he can employ them at that age legally. That's another matter. These are things which have to change with our times. But it will be fantastic for those people in those small cities, having finished 5+3, to start doing rotoscopy and then use the money which they themselves are earning to go to the next level and learn the next thing. Because now Rajesh has mentioned that things are happening remotely and they can continue learning at the same time as they grow. So this is not only for people in engineering and not only people who are graduating, but there are people all the way from class 8 to PhD who can enter this industry and go out and come in at different points of time and contribute to the different things that happen here. And that the skill sets that you have are tremendous. And when you talked about how successful we are as an industry and we are all the doyens of industry, you know, we like the flattery, but it is entirely not true. We are 0.5% of the world market in terms of what we produce. Okay, which means that that's the opportunity. It doesn't mean that we have arrived. It means that that is what. Luckily for us, we have got the lighthouse projects and the lighthouse companies and the lighthouse people that I can show that we can do it. Because the belief that India could do this 10, 15, 20 years did not exist. You know, people like Rajesh and I have been going to Cannes from 2002 or 2001 or whenever it was to talk to people, where we had to explain to them, first of all, when they look out of the window, they didn't know which way to look where India was. That has changed quite a lot. Okay. Then we have to explain that we do animation, and they say, like, what have you done? And we hadn't done anything at that time. So there are many things that are advantages to the young talent. And I think what's most advantages of all is they can pick their timing. They can pick their skill set. They can pick their focus. And they can pick where they want to go in a laddered approach, because you can't learn everything at one time. And it is also not necessary for you to learn everything at one time. And I wanted to, if time permits in the end, I have got a couple of show reels. One is on advertising. In advertising, the projects finish in 3 to 4 weeks. In episodic, what Rajesh does and I, what Rajiv does and I do, the projects may finish in 1.5 years, 1 to 2 years time. In movies, and we make 19 or 18 or 19 movies, you know, and visual effects in our company, and Mike works on a lot of them for many of the world leaders and with us and others. The project takes 3 or 4 years. Our work could take 1.5 to 2 years time. So there are long form projects and there are short form projects. And what is going to change in India in 5 years for sure, and I hope it does, is that if you look at jobs in India, there are more jobs in the unregulated world than there are in the employment world. And animation, visual effects and games is the only sector in media entertainment in India that has employees. It is the only sector in India. Balaji Television, I don't know the number, I'm making it up, I'm giving you an indication. They may have 5,000 people working or 10,000 people working today on all their projects, but they will have only maybe 200 employees out of that. The rest are, and each show, they bring the right cinematographer, etc. And the float, the free float of talent we have in live action, in cinematography, in direction, etc. is fantastic. You can tell me that your astrologer has told you that you want a cinematographer whose name starts with C and I'll get you 45 good guys. Okay. but in animation, because we do not have adequate talent, free float of talent yet, I foresee that a lot of people will come into this industry with different models of engagement. They will work on their own projects because they want to be their own, they want to be the next Rajiv. They will come and work in service companies for 6 months or 8 months a year because that's what they want to do. And it will become a win-win for both the employer as well as the employee as this talent base grows. So the opportunity for talent growth is bigger than what I'm employing or Rajiv is employing or Mike is employing. It's far bigger than that. We need to create the model, the formality of how they can become like the live action industry is the big thing. And maybe, and I will recommend this because I have a huge, huge admiration for, you know, K.T. Ramarao Gadu and also for Jayesh Ranjan and the whole team, all of you at Telangana, because you're visionary. Maybe some platform needs to be created where people can register themselves for being available for work in skill sets. And companies can come and hire them for a week or a month or whatever. That's the biggest service you can give to talent today, rather than just wait to be employed. And I want to make sure that the 600, 800 people on this call do not think the only thing that they will get is a great job. Because what happens is that the demoralization in our country where people don't get a job is so great, they lose focus and they completely fall apart. And our unemployment today for this sector is 16%, although the overall unemployment may be 6. So I really feel that we want to use technology and talent to overcome the mindsets that we have that have come up to where we are today. And I think that's really what I want to end on right now on the next 5 year story.
Great. Thanks, Biren. And thanks for bringing out all those points. And thank you also for bringing out a point that, look, learning is a lifelong process. It's not 17 plus 4 plus full stop plus 17 plus 4 plus 40. And I'm sure you're not 40 yet, so that's fine. So moving on to Rajiv. Rajiv, since we've been speaking about a lot of things, help us understand, and Biren also said that you'll be able to throw some light on it. You know, what are the different entry points for freshers, especially in the animation sector? And since you're also developing original content, there might be some designing, storyboarding and art direction skills also that might be needed in your line. So if you can also help us understand that, you know, designing characters, environment from a conceptual level, what are the skills that you look at? And also if you could talk about the Indian IP in that space.
Sure.
What is the growth for the student if he starts at the lower rung of the whole pyramid over here? What is the future for him? And as well as, you know, probably talking about some of the very specific skills that your domain requires. And also one more question which I would like to ask you is, Disney normally does a gong show to decide the next idea. For example, Mulan was done through a gong show, etc. Do you have something similar where, you know, or how do you get the ideas? So over to you, Rajiv.
Thank you. I think, I'll start. You have asked me so many questions. I'm not so smart to remember all of them, but I will try to address all of them. So starting with the first basic one, I mean, the good thing that the entry point, talking about entry point, the fantastic thing about the industry of animation, art, VFX, gaming, the fantastic, it's a visual medium. So basically, which means that nobody can fool you that I'm a great artist. Whereas if you, or no one needs to be, you know, having a degree or, you know, a PhD from a certain university or any of that sort of thing. It's the most important thing is like if you're able to start your career in a good company, then you have very likely chance that you will go higher up more easily than if you're wrong, working in a wrong place for a higher salary. So it's important where you start. But coming back, in the good thing about this industry is that you don't need a degree, or that doesn't mean you shouldn't have a degree. The degree is better to have. But more importantly, you don't need to be highly educated, or you know, you don't need to get a degree from the US or England or Singapore, whatever. You could be somebody who's self-made. You know, your art could be self-made. You could have taught yourself those skills on digitally or through an institute, an animation institute, or you know, could be a university. So it doesn't matter where you come from, but there are various starting points in the animation segment, and especially for a company like Green Gold, you know, we are looking for somebody with basic drawing skills also. Somebody who can draw characters, or somebody who can draw sceneries, or we call it layout and backgrounds in the field of animation. So somebody who has got perspective sense always works better in the layout. So like 1 point, 2 point, 3 point. It's a very simple technique. So somebody who knows drawing, but he doesn't know the technique of 1 point, 2 point, or 3 point perspective can easily teach that in probably in a week's class in layout or design. So there are many skills. So one is, like I said, drawing. Okay, what if you don't know draw, but you can paint very well? Nowadays, you don't need to go and buy canvas or, you know, paints and stuff. Everything is in Photoshop or even many free software. So you can paint and see how good you are. I mean, see, I believe everyone is creative in some way or the other. We all don't believe that. I think even an accountant can be creative in his own way. And we need to find that in ourselves. So I think one thing to understand is that, example, somebody may have good fashion sense, you know, like our friend Biren, you know, always dressed for the occasion, handsome. You know, if you have seen his LinkedIn profiles, he's got some new style. He was in IPL. He was camera focused on him and his daughter, I think 2 years ago, 1 year ago. So I think, yeah, like he's creative too. I mean, so what I mean to say is that somebody with a fashion sense, somebody with color sense, somebody with camera sense, you know, how do you place the camera? Sometimes the most, I mean, is it, example, if you give a simple camera to Shah Rukh's traditional pose that he does always in every movie of his, if you give a silly camera move on that, it looks terrible, the shot. But if you make the same camera move in a certain angle, in a crane shot, that kind of thing, the same shot looks spectacular. Now, that's creativity too, but you need engineering too. So again, in the 2D world, so in animation industry, there's basically the 2D world and the 3D world. So in the 2D world, this is something that is your raw skills, your drawing, your coloring, and those things. In the 3D world, when you need a skill top of your creative skills, which is the software skill, you need to figure out how to do that. Once you know that, and sadly, you have to keep upgrading your software skills all the time, because I think when we started out in 2002-03, I think it was Softimage, 3D Studio Max, a number of other softwares which you have not even heard of, today don't exist. Then this Maya came, and Maya was the software Maya is lasted for a long time, still continues to do. And then the last 5, 6, 7 years, we've been hearing about Unity and Unreal, then Blender, and slowly these have been rising up. So as an artist, and then of course, in texturing side of things, there a number of new softwares have come up. I mean, it's not just Maya alone you can texture. So today it's like not just a good artist is not somebody who's doing great work with this thing, but he knows which plugin to use for what. So, I mean, unless you know this is the plugin that I need to use for this certain kind of shot, it is really difficult. So it is very complicated as you go up the order. But to start with, now coming to the entry point wise, you can start anywhere, you know, a basic basic somebody who can, who knows Photoshop or who knows drawing is our foundation artist. Somebody who can draw thumbnails. You don't need to be really fabulous drawing skills. You know, example, a storyboard artist is a rare, the rarest of the rare skill in our industry, because he's somebody who can, who knows how to draw and also how to direct the whole thing. The storyboard artist becomes the most important person in the entire, especially when you produce an IP, he becomes the most important artist. And that job, it has to be done, but that episode example has to be only done by one person or one or two people at the maximum. So it's his vision that goes on to the entire episode. So the storyboard artist, as long as he knows how to draw, thumbnails also is sometimes enough to communicate a thing. So hence, drawing becomes such an important skill. So that, so coming back to the second question is how they can grow. I'll tell you, so there are people who I've hired in the year 2007. There were about a bunch of 30 or 40 graduates from Toon Webel School in Kolkata, which we bought in because that time the skilled artists were very difficult to find, so we had to hire freshers. Now, out of those 30, 40 people, almost half of them are still with us. And out of about 10% of them have gone on to become the department heads or the directors or very important key positions in our company. So somebody who started their career as less at 7,000-8,000 rupees, now they're drawing more than 30x of that, which is, they've come a long way. So it is very interesting that how you can grow yourself. Of course, all these guys had their own adventures and went and worked different places and came back, rejoined with better skill set and stuff. Definitely, we have a starting point, but there is, of course, the ending point is it keeps going. Like I said, new softwares, new technologies, constantly you need to teach. I mean, from animation, like Barbarian said earlier, you need to know a bit of everything from physics, geometry, anatomy, you know, how the teeth look, dentist. You have to understand everything about everything. You have to, astronomy, you have to understand how the clouds form. You need to show that depict. You have to see what the ground, how do you, a reflective surface look? How does a transparent surface look? It is crazy. I mean, you can, it is, it's, I think we are more like scientists, actually. We should be called scientists, not animators. Because that kind of knowledge, I don't know how we are able to put everything together. So talking about the skill set part, like I said, we have to constantly keep upgrading ourselves. And one important thing is that for the task, I would think that we need to introduce drawing and certain things right from school levels. And right now I've seen online classes of my kids. So talking about kids, I think Amarnath Gar, you were talking about my brother's daughter. She's a tennis player. My daughter is in grade 3. So I don't think it's the same. But anyways, so my elder brother's daughter is a tennis player and she's doing fantastic. She's, I think, All India number 6 ranked. So hopefully she'll play Wimbledon soon. Let's see. Coming back to the skill set, I think if we are able to teach drawing at school level, I mean, that is something that will change the way everything is this thing. I think Amarnath Garu spoke a little while ago about iconic buildings. And I'm sure all these have been designed on paper and pencil before they become whatever buildings they are going to become. So and we need to understand the importance of artists. We need to promote them. I have not seen any artists getting recognized anywhere in India in a long time. I mean, we need to recognize these are the guys who are building our city. I mean, they're building our, I mean, the drawing side, the cities or entertainment, like, and I've been talking about entertainment. If it is going to be part of life, there shouldn't be an entertainment tax. I mean, we should all hopefully enjoy that part. And we all need that. We recognize that. Then, I think at school level, we need to, creative skills have to be taught. I think the teachers should teach drawing online or whatever it is also, because that is where you need to teach art, not when somebody is 20-year-old or 40-year-old or whatever. that's where, I mean, grassroots levels, we have to take care of that. I've seen that our Prime Minister has come up with a great, brilliant new strategy for education, something that is going to change the way India is going to look at in the next decade or two. But also, we should never underestimate the importance of art, culture, what India has and stuff. And we should put that into our system and also recognize those people. I mean, today parents put, if they get kids get A grade in mathematics, they put it, they stick it up in the walls. But if you go to Bengal, Kolkata, if they do first, they get a beautiful painting and they get 10 out of 10, the parents paste it on there. I think Bengal is the only place I know they do still Saraswati Puja. I think we have stopped. I think Telangana also should do that. We are only doing, I mean, most of India is only praying to Lakshmi, you know. We must respect art, and we must all do Saraswati Puja, recognize artists. And those kind of things we have to do, things, the musicians, the singers, the voice actors, so many, the writers. I mean, these guys have been, I was doing some research on Panchatantra, and I realized that the Panchatantra was created by a great guru in order to teach a king's children who were pretty not very smart about education. So he used the medium of animation or creating these animal characters to teach some lessons. So that's how that was done, like centuries ago. I think that's an important thing. Last but the least, you talked about IPs, creating IPs and stuff, creating a product. I think that's one of the most difficult things I would say to do, because you need to understand the pulse of the market. We need to understand what do I create it for? You know, who am I creating for? So when we created Bheem, one important thing I understood that Indians had no character to associate themselves with. I mean, I've seen villagers or somebody who's watching animated shows where they're talking about hamburger or Easter or some kind of thing on the show. So they start feeling inferior. Hey, I don't know what is Easter, or I don't know what is hamburger. They start feeling inferior, and you're growing up thinking the West is superior. I don't think in any way the world, anyone in the world is superior to us, to Indians. I think at best we are all equals. If not, Indians are better, I would say. But spiritually, we are much advanced thing, and we must understand that. We must bring that confidence to the little children, and that has to be done through any form that comes to. And we need to believe that we are one of the best. You know, the brains versus physically, I wouldn't say we can be, because whatever food or thing we consume, we are a different kind of thing. But it's important to understand we are the smartest people, most creative people in the world. So as you know, I love India, and I would like to always do a lot more content for India, and we're working on many more. I think skill wise, that's it from me. Over to the other guys.
Thanks, Rajiv. You still did not talk about the gong show method or how do you select, but probably we'll come to that later on, just in the rest of time. Mike, let me move on to you now. And since visual effects have different kind of things, and probably you can also mention some of the movies where your visual effects have been used. So how is it transforming in the present time? And also if you could help us understand, you know, what technologies do the students need to learn to get a job in the VFX sector? And what is the potential? Because Biren also spoke about different engagement models. So I want to understand from you is how entrepreneurship or gig economy can also play a role in this sector. Yeah. Over to you, Mike.
So I suggest students who have a passion towards creativity and movies, passion towards a movie watching, a movie understanding, you know, the creative part, they should select this kind of field, especially for the visual effects, you know, because it doesn't matter you study 10th or intermediate or a degree or engineering. It matters how much you're passionate towards this kind of creativity and interest in the movies. Most of our students who have studied 10th or intermediate are doing very good in this industry. So definitely passion is a must to be in the industry. If you don't have passion, it's going to be tough. And as far as movies we have done, you know, we have worked more than, 1200. We have worked more than 1200 movies. And we work roto and visual. In the roto, we do elements of visual effects. We don't do the complete visual effects. We do the elements of visual effects like rotoscoping, paint remover, wire, match moving and that. This again has been again sent to the Hollywood studios. They finally compose it and they do the DA grading and insert into the movie industry. So we have so that we have around 275 clients all over the world. We work for 18 countries. So there are a lot of projects, you know, advertisements, commercials, and TV shows we have worked. And we have worked with the most of the car commercials and also Burger King, you know, McDonald's, and movies, the latest movies we have worked, and upcoming movies also we are working, and some are confidential. We can't disclose as we have NCNDA. And for the student, what I suggest is that, you know, focus, identify your interest at the level of intermediate or degree. Parallelly start, go for training schools like, you know, you can go to Frameworks, you can go to Arena Animation, Mac Animation, you know, even Rotomaker. We also have 7 academies in different cities in Hyderabad and Bangalore. We train students who have interest towards visual effects. We train them. And after like 1 year or 2 years training, we take them into jobs. So once the students get into any of these training centers, they learn 2 years course that the teachers tells they can identify their interest towards animation or VFX or gaming, then they decide and choose the career. So these courses are more career oriented, you know, so that you select this course, that means you know what you're going to become. So, once you select your visual effects course or animation course or gaming course, definitely you're going to get a job opportunity in that and you're definitely going to be successful in that. So the classes, you know, most of the schools are giving pretty much good. All the schools are good. They should study, understand which school is convenient for them. And that definitely the career opportunities is good in the animation gaming sector. So they can definitely pick out this site, you know. Yeah.
Thanks, Mike. Helpful. And of course, we would not like you to divulge any, NDA information over here. But yes. Good to know that, you know, working with so many partners and so many movies, etc., you have done. I think a lot of our students would have seen those movies without realizing that, you know, the effects were done here in Telangana itself. So, Rajesh, moving on to you now, probably if you could help us understand, you know, even before, and as you said, that potential. So, for IT, it's very simple. You do a hackathon, you see who's good in coding, you identify that person and get him on board. But in your kind of a field, can you do some kind of a hackathon, or how do you actually look at which student should pursue what kind of skills, right? That is the first question. How do you judge the potential of a candidate and what skill sets a student should do? Second question to you is, how do you decide on the method by which you will train and develop these skills? Because, you know, different things would be done differently. What kind of creative and technology knowledge should students need to learn in order to get a job in this sector? And how do you suggest they adjust to changing times? As you said, the software keeps on changing. And most importantly, because some people have already started asking those questions, is there some certification that is a minimum requirement and for a job, or how should they continue to learn new skills even in the future, even when they are employed? And how do you help with that?
Okay.
First, a very long question.
Yes. First, the selection process. What we do, first of all, let me be very clear. The students who come to, you know, even inquire, 95% plus are the people who are interested in this industry. And they may not know which part they want to go to, but they are interested in this animation, visual effects, gaming field as such. And that is one of the things that I've seen, that they don't just walk in, you know, just to find out, and they want to actually do accountancy and come here and check what animation is. So there are a lot of people who are of that bent of mind who want to do enter this field only, and then they come to take a class or to inquire about what kind of education they can take. At that time, my counselor actually talks to them and finds out, gauges what his interest is actually, whether he wants to go to photography or whether he wants to go to animation, whether he wants to go to, you know, VFX kind of, what will be his kind of nature. Also, we do a kind of test where if he's got the creative drawing skills, like Rajiv said, if the drawing skills are there, they go into the visualization, previs, or, you know, creation of assets. And if he has more technical skills, then we talk something about, you know, doing a roto or, you know, comp kind of job, or maybe even just rendering would be the final thing. But I would say everybody needs to go through the basics of all the kind of aspects of animation and visual effects, because once they go through that, then they can work in a team. They know where they have to give their stuff, what is coming downline to them and what is going up, you know, to the other people. So all this kind of things they need to know. So we design a course for them after seeing that they have to do a basics in everything that is there in the field, and then a specialization in the field that they choose or of their caliber. So once they've gone through like almost 6 months of our courses, we know that, you know, they will be, we will recommend to them that you do visual effects or you do animation, you do modeling, you do texturing, or you get into some technical aspects. So that then he's counseled again to do this kind of things. So that was one of the things that, one of the questions. The second question, now I'll have to remember, you had a lot of questions. Certification was the other thing that you were discussing. Certification is not that important for the job. It's the quality of your showreel and what you can do is more important. From what I've heard from all the HR people, they say we look at the showreel and what he can do rather than what certificate somebody has issued him. And there's no age or nothing that matters. You can be a fresher or you can be a 10-year, you know, into the industry. But if you got the skill set, you'll be taken into a job that could be much higher paying or lower paying than you expect. So, you know, those things are the things that the HR will decide once you show them your showreel and your capability. But certification is important just as to prove that, yes, you've gone through certain kind of course and certain amount of formal training. So that's what they require. But the showreel is more important than the certification. And I'm sure Biren and Rajiv will agree that, yes, they would like to see the work rather than the certificate. The other aspects in this times, sorry, could you just repeat one of the second question, please?
The second question was, what creative and technology knowledge do students need to learn in order to get a job?
Yeah.
And how do you adjust in these changing times?
Right. So right now, like I said, Framebox 2.0 was one of the adjustments that we did. We brought in curriculum that is more relevant to today's time. Like 3D Studio Max used to be one of the max, you know, the things that we used to teach maximum of, and we now are looking at other, you know, things that are coming in AR, VR. We are looking at things like Unreal, Unity, Blender. All these aspects are now coming into our courseware. So these things have to be done, and they have to know these newer technologies that are coming in. In VFX, there are things that are, you know, the LED shootings are going to come, or the NCAM, as you know, systems are going to come. So we, of course, can't afford those kind of things in the education sector. But we have to kind of at least orient them on those new technologies that are going to come, keep on coming. As Biren said, you have to keep on upskilling yourself. So whether you have done a course of 3 years or 6 months in our institute, a constant updation is also required, and which is what we are now coming up with, new webinars and you know, boot camps and workshops for all our students and anybody from the industry who wants, from industry experts. So these are the things. Because of COVID, we have been able to do it, and a lot of webinars are attended by a lot of people from the industry and from and students. So those are the things that will be more important to them, and they'll keep on upgrading their skill sets as time goes along. And of course, we keep on interacting with the studios to find out what they need, what are the kind of courseware that, what are the kind of skill sets they would need from their employees.
Okay.
One more point about Biren's thing: freelance is going to be a very big thing, as you are going to be, you know, in your native place, or you're going to be in your villages or whatever. You are not going to be all the time, you know, in the city. You don't need to be all the time in the city. If you learn how to deliver what these, you know, studios want freelance, you could do it from your home. And you could do it from your village, or you can. So these, you just looking for a job is not important. Skilling yourself enough for the studio to want your skills is the most important thing.
Great, thanks. And about updation. How do you keep yourself updated? Anything on that? Any thoughts?
Yes, that's what I said. We have started a process, and you should keep on skilling yourself by updating with the latest technologies that have been introduced. And we are now introducing webinars and workshops and boot camps in those kind of new technologies that will come up to upgrade the skills of the students who have already passed out and need that upgradation.
Okay. Thanks, Rajesh. That was helpful. So we still have a couple of minutes before Jayan sir joins us, and we will be also taking the questions later on. But in the meantime, I would request Biren to just show what a showreel actually looks like and what the Indian animation industry has actually delivered. So Malika and Biren, in case you can get the video up, please.
So I am going to just start by saying that we talked about a lot of things. I have uploaded two very quick reels, one to show short form. And good evening, Jayesh Anjanji. Good to see you, as always.
No, please continue, Biranji. Look forward to listening to you.
I wanted to just, before we come to the reels, Shrikant,
yeah,
because we have, 800-900 young people on the call. See, the thing about visual effects, even though Mike talked about the short-term issues that we are having, the difference between some of the things that we do for the global market in services and other stuff is that we are now seeing around, I think last year there were about 2,412 certified movies within India.
Wow.
And currently there are about 350 broadcasters. We already have between 40 to 45 streaming channels that have started in India. Every single content that is created, almost every single content that is created, has a percentage of visual effects. It could be 5% just for titling and whatever. It could be all the way up to about 85% of it. And so it's important to know that as the industry, the larger industry, needs visual effects for everything, while only the fully animated projects are fully animated. But the animation, visual effects is kind of a, animation in live action, basically. So that's one important point that I wanted to make here. The second is that as we see the streaming channels come up, they are giving rise to new genres of entertainment. So people on this call in the past, the television episodes were mostly the soaps, for the households and substantially aimed at the housewife. But today, all kinds of new formats, new genres, etc., have come in, and people are watching things on their own time in their own way. And the potential for that has got huge. The third thing I wanted to say to people who are on this call is before they look for jobs in, either Rajiv's company or Mike's company or my company or anyone, it is important for them to know that they can create small projects today because of the rise of platforms. So one thing that will change between this seminar and the one that Shrikant you arrange 1 year from now will be the arrival of a platform. So if you take, for example, the Jio platforms, the Jio platform is growing at an exponential rate where Jio creates the platform. It's a little bit like what Amar talked about, image and the infrastructure that Telangana is creating for people to come and use that infrastructure. So you see that Jio is a virtual platform giving rise to hundreds and thousands of indie developers who will create their own games and monetize it on those platforms. It's already happening. There are people who have made from a few thousand to tens of thousands to hundreds of thousands of dollars just putting their game on that platform. So we did not only look at the kind of thing I'm going to show you in the reel. We did not look at only making the next Mighty Little Beam, although we will celebrate all of those things that we do. But there are things that can be done at a student level, at an individual level. And I think the startup ecosystem that Telangana wants to promote should start looking at helping people who are in this community that is on this call today. And I'm happy to be one of the mentors, and I'm sure my other colleagues here will join. How do they create shorts? How they create small things that can today go online onto YouTube, onto Jio, onto other places. And that itself is going to build up their own skill set and their credibility. They can do that on the side of whatever they are studying, in engineering or in undergraduation or whatever. And it gives the opportunity, because we talked about this earlier, that someone is pursuing medicine or accountancy because his father or her father asked her to. But they can actually prove to their own parents, to themselves, and to the rest of the world that, hey, you know what, I can actually be creating some content also. I think this is a point we didn't want to leave out in this conversation. And I think that itself will give them that encouragement. They don't need to be, not everybody needs to graduate and then create something. So I wanted to preface that the opportunity in the number of movies and the content we create in India is exploding right now. And you can be a content creator starting with your own shorts and then participating in the bigger game as you go along. And it's not leave out from mention that the biggest visual effects movies are the ones that are being created in Telangana today. Because we know that, you know, the mounting of the big movies that create thousands and thousands of jobs, similar to what we do as a company in Hollywood and other places, is now beginning to happen in our own country. So I wanted not to leave Mike and the wonderful talent that we have, and I had the pleasure of helping them curate a fantastic VFX track, which was the hit of the last year's show. Mike, we should do it again this year, right? And we have more students coming in there. And streaming, maybe if TASC can collaborate with the event that we put together in Hyderabad with BSG, so, you know, is a big mentor for and a supporter of. We should be streaming those people talking to all of the colleges who are on this call in the future, in the year to come, maybe. That would be a good idea. So very quickly, in the interest of time, we were all looking forward to hearing JSG. I will play only one of the reels to show how we are communication outside of Chota Bheem and outside of all the big movies we make for James Bond, Pirates of the Caribbean, and the Oscar we won this year for 1917, and everybody saw Lion King last year that my company worked 100% on. And it was actually conceptualized inside when Rajiv talked about storyboarding as a very key part of the future. Today, storyboards are created in the most unusual manner, inside the VR headset. Everything is fixed inside the VR headset, and then you start doing the animation for the movie. So I think quickly we'll show something, because you should never have an audiovisual conference without showing 1 minute of audiovisual. I'll request your colleague to put the advertising reel, and then look forward to hearing from Jayesh ji and questions.
Malika, can you help us in putting the first film?
Yes, sir. I'm doing it.
Thank you.
Most important thing I wanted to bring to the audience on this was that, you know, what artists like a lot is that they can work on many, many different styles. And I think one of the things there which is not very easy to recognize is that computer graphics did all of that. So it was a car in a tunnel. It was not really a car in a tunnel. There were people. You saw water. It was not really water. You saw the desert and somebody walking. That was Sir Ridley Scott's commercial for Louis Vuitton. And I think what we started this meeting was is the rise of virtual production in live action. Most of the people that are shooting today in Telangana, all the big filmmakers, the small filmmakers, will embrace CG for a lot more because of all the problems of today. And I think the learning from that, three things are going to happen. One is, neither Rajiv nor Mike or I could have said 1 year back that if you send all of our people away from our studio, all their homes will become our studio. We would not have agreed. But somehow we've had to do that now. The second thing is, how does CG replicate things like environments and even characters? So we are inviting very shortly on a webinar the world's first creator of the digital human, Paul Devereck, to talk to our companies all over India. And today you see that for those of you who were seeing Jungle Book and you saw one boy and everything else was CG, but that boy was not real for quite a few scenes of that movie. So these are the things that are coming out, I think, which are exciting, and young people embrace it even in faster than us. And I'd like to just end there. I don't think we need to play the second reel. We can always put it up and people can be sent links, I think, who are on this call. So I'll give it back to you, Srikant, in the interest of time to hear the special address from JSG.
Sure. Thank you, Biren. And what you said is absolutely right. We started with Who Framed Roger Rabbit, where the animated character and the human character were together. And I think that's where the industry would head. It's indeed my honor and a privilege to introduce a person who doesn't need any introduction, at least for this audience, be it the panelists or the participants. But I'll be failing in my duty if I don't talk about Jayesh Ranjanji, who is the topper of the 1992 IAS batch and has been the force and the power behind Telangana, along with the Honorable Minister, the policies, the processes, the various organizations that have been set up over here, which are proactive, are all thanks to JSG itself. And he himself holds a master's degree in psychology from Delhi University and has a degree in business management from Indian Institute of Management, Calcutta. Plus, he has the distinction of doing a program from the Lee Kuan Yew School of Public Policy on public management from NUS or National University of Singapore. And of course, he is the person who guides TASC as the vice chairman, as well as the secretary for IT, industries, commerce, as well as the acting vice chancellor for JNTU. All of us are very keen to hear your thoughts on this as we start this journey of training and skilling the youth in Telangana for the industry. Over to you, sir.
Thank you. good evening, all the participants. Let me first of all express my gratitude to TASC for organizing this very vital session as a part of its career talk series. Gives, as you mentioned, there are almost 750 to 800 students who are listening in. So definitely, this would have been a very meaningful and a very informative session. I am also very grateful to all the eminent panelists from the industry, and also my colleague Amarnath, also industry stalwarts like Biren Ghosh, Rajiv, Rajesh, Mike. Glad that you could spend an hour's time, basically to interact and educate students and people who are looking at newer career alternatives, because people of your stature typically delegate all these kind of things to much junior people in your organization. But the fact that you yourself came and spent time with the students, that is something really wonderful and shows how deep your interest is in growing this sector. So gratitude and compliments to all of you. Now, let me mention a few things. See, this sector definitely is becoming more and more important. And the COVID scenario has made the importance of this sector even more visible and obvious and immediate. Let me give an example. See, education is one activity which has been disrupted very badly because of the physical distancing norms, social distancing norms. and it is still not clear when will the schools open, colleges open. I'm also the vice chancellor of a university for the last 1 year in an officiating capacity. Even we are struggling, and these are not school children. These are grown-up students, college students, and still we are in a bind on how do you introduce online courses to them. But the other challenge which we have seen that while private schools and schools where children are from prosperous families, etc., they have started online education. Many of the parents complained that the child has found novel ways or innovative ways to evade that education. So, for example, right now I'm speaking to all of you. Many of you can immediately turn off your camera and you can do whatever you want to. You can even go and take a nap. Actually, it happened with me also. I was on a board meeting and I found that the occasion was so dry and boring that I fell asleep. And only at the end, when someone was calling my name, I woke up and I switched my camera and I was able to rejoin the conversation. So the levels of engagement is definitely not the same. And though we have started online education, but we just are not sure whether the teaching learning process is giving any result at all or not. And therefore, there is a very important need to develop content which is much more engaging. And obviously, the very intuitive and common sense answer is that that content can come if you introduce lots of animation, if you use lots of CG, visual effects, make concepts speak out to the student as they are being presented on the screen, so to say. And the level of intensity, the level of excitement in that content is what will drive the attention of the student. Even if he wants to sleep, he will not do so because what is coming on his screen is so interesting and so fascinating. So if the future of education is online, and if we know that just coming on a Zoom call and speaking and lecturing will not at all engage the students, then I'm sure very, very rapidly this realization will come that we require a huge dose of animation and CG and VFX, etc. So in Telangana also, our education department has started this conversation. We have also realized that while we have great teachers who can give good ideas on how to convert a textbook into an there is no physical way of teaching and coaching the students. Again, online systems which are engaging, which have the ability to attract the user, the viewer's attention, these will matter quite a lot. And most importantly, the nature of digital entertainment itself has changed and has expanded, in my opinion, quite a lot. In fact, I know of many families, including my own family, which have now subscribed to all possible OTT formats because something or the other is every day getting introduced. There are sports coming on OTT, there are serials, there are films and documentaries and all kinds of things. And therefore, the ability to showcase your content, your creative work also gets enhanced to that extent. And all these are very positive signs. Another thing which, of course, right now people feel that this is only a stress buster and people are doubtful about its sustainability. But I do not really believe that way. I believe that this is something which will also stand in the long run is spending time playing games, video games, computer games, games on your devices, etc. Gaming, again, is becoming a very, very important thing. When people are having much more free time at hand because the time for commute has come down extremely, and therefore you can finish your work easier and you can do lots of things from home itself. So you have at the end of the day lots of time with you, and I know of many people who have started playing online games very, very frequently. I myself play this Ludo quite frequently and find it to be a very addictive kind of game. And I'm also aware of two, three very important national trends which are happening. I'm sure all of you know this, that there is a major campaign launched by the Prime Minister, by the national government, called Atmanirbhar Bharat, Atmanirbhar India, Self-Reliant India. And in that also, lots of encouragement is being given. So all of you would know that the government actually banned 60 odd products and apps and solutions which had Chinese origin. Of course, it was because of nationalistic reason, but the spirit behind this Atmanirbhar campaign is that if we have the talent to do it for others, why not do it for ourselves? I mean, it boils down to this simple message. And again, many of you would know, the national government ran a competition when 69 apps and products were banned. Of course, there could have been a vacuum also, because I know that there are millions of people who use TikTok and who use other kind of Chinese games, etc. See, if everything is banned all of a sudden, there is a vacuum and you need to kind of fill that vacuum. And the government ran a national challenge competition, which was called Atmanirbhar India. Yeah, Innovate for Atmanirbhar India. That was the name of the competition. And again, very good quality solutions were submitted for that competition. In fact, I feel very proud to share this with you. I mean, of course, the local players know this, but Dhiren, you may not know this. The first prize in the gaming category was actually won by a Hyderabad-based gaming company. It's a company which developed a sports-related game, a cricket game actually. It's called the Hit Wicket. And they won the first prize in the national competition. So, goes to show the kind of talent and the kind of support structures which are available to people in Hyderabad. And of course, after they have won the first prize, their popularity has gone up. They have received lots of commendation. And most importantly, large number of users have downloaded their solutions. Even in fact, even before this Chinese ban, when the lockdown started, I'm sure all of you will recall that the necessity to have a video conferencing solution, because lots of official work, lots of meetings, lots of conferencing was happening through video conferencing tools. And we were using tools which are available earlier also. I mean, not that they were created due to COVID. They were available earlier also, but there was an issue about who is storing your data. When you come on a call, where does your data get stored? Who is the custodian of that data? And again, lots of issues about national sovereignty, national security was raised. And the national IT ministry actually had run a challenge on asking in the local homegrown solution providers, innovators to create video conferencing solutions. And again, I'm happy to let you know that 12 of them have been shortlisted, and now they have been given some encouragement to refine their product further. Three of them are from Hyderabad, and one of them is this, the tool that we are using right now. So Okta is one of the 12 finalists in the search for, and we are on this platform for the last 1 hour, and I'm sure your experience has been very, very good. I mean, I've used it on multiple times. This has become the standard default platform for all my interdepartmental reviews and meetings and all, but the quality of the experience, for example, we saw the movie just now. I mean, we saw the film a while ago, the quality, the sound, the picture, and right now on my screen, I can see you all are there, but also the public chat, lots of questions are coming and I can read all the questions and I can see the participants, I can see the screen. So very versatile kind of a solution, and in terms of quality, no different at all from, let us say, the best of what the Microsofts of the world or the Googles of the world, etc., or the Ciscos of the world can create. So there is lots of talent in our country, and if the right kind of guidance is given to that talent, there is no doubt in my mind that the solutions that we require for digital transformation, for enhancing consumer experience, for various kinds of problems which people face today, they can all be done by homegrown talent, by homegrown companies. And therefore, in this context, the career talk today is very relevant. I'm confident that a large number of students who are listening to all the experts today, who are listening to me right now, I'm sure that this will trigger a thought process in their minds on how this can also be a very viable career option. And again, as I mentioned, this is a skill which does not require too much of academic brilliance. It is not that unless you are a gold medalist in computer science, only then you can make a career in the animation and gaming and VFX industry. You can study whatever you have studied, whatever your marks are. These things don't matter. of course, the interest to learn the technologies that are used in this industry, and the interest, the ability to work hard, and the ability to really meet the expectations of the stakeholders. These things matter the most. So I've just glanced at some of the questions which participants are putting in the public chat. Of course, each of them deserve a detailed answer as well. But all I can say is that none of these things, so someone is asking whether a two-year course is important or a one-year course is important, and what are the skills required. I mean, this is one sector which can cater to every possible requirement. If you are prepared to just spend 3 months to learn something and get into the job market right away, there are opportunities for you. You can attend a 3 month course also and get into it. If you want to do something very, very high end and then get into this industry, opportunities are available there. And it is regardless of what your earlier background is. You don't have to be an engineer or a computer science or anything. You could have studied anything. And even if you have done something else, you can very easily transit into this. I have seen, I've been to some of the studios. I've been to Rajiv's studio. I've been to DQ, and I've seen a couple of other studios also. I've interacted with staff who were working there at random. And I came across many people who were studying, who were students of fine arts, who had studied commerce, who had, of course, studied science, who had studied engineering, but they were able to be assimilated in this industry, and they are doing very well. And as I said, because the importance of this industry is growing, more and more opportunities for this industry is coming up. I'm sure that the pay scales, the salary levels, the opportunity to get global work moved to India, all that will also come. And therefore, the conditions of this industry, not to say that they are not good at this point in time, but definitely they will go much, much more. They will improve much, much more. So this is a paying industry, a good industry, a safe industry. The industry is also very well organized. We have Twaga in Hyderabad. All the Hyderabad industry is associated with that association, and they look after each other's interests. I know that there is Abai in Bangalore, and that is also a very strong industry group. They also kind of help each other. So one industry where there is no unhealthy kind of competition. I know of so many other industries where, unfortunately, the industry practices are not good, so to say. But I can't say anything about this industry in any of that form. And the government has also done many things. My colleague Amarnath would have already spoken about them. The latest intervention, it is a joint intervention by Government of India and state government, is to set up a center of excellence in animation, gaming, AR and VR in Hyderabad. And again, unfortunately, this pandemic has slightly delayed our activities. We have not yet been able to finalize the position of the director of that COE and get the staff there. But I'm sure that now that things are becoming more or less normal, we will be able to make the COE also up and running. That will give a bigger boost to Hyderabad. And one of the important tasks which we will be doing through that COE is to bring as much as international business as possible to India. All of you, I'm sure, know this, that there is a very strong anti-China sentiment prevailing across the world, and we should capitalize on it. India, Hyderabad, Bangalore, these are the best locations to get all these people who want to come out of China and look at safer but high-quality destinations. So we will be using the COE to position ourselves as that high-quality, affordable, and a safe and stable destination for the AVCGI industry. So I look forward to continued guidance and support of all the industry veterans who are on this call today. TASC should also continue this engagement with students. While this webinar is a great way to engage with them, but suppose a college or a cluster of colleges finds a number of students who are seriously interested in it, we should actually give them much more practical solutions on after doing which course, what certification is possible, what are the entry-level jobs. Let us bring out a fact book, so to say, for prospective students with the help of Twaga. And if we are able to disseminate it widely, I'm sure there'll be many, many takers for these kind of opportunities. So once again, congratulations, best wishes to all the students. And I do hope that many of you will get motivated and influenced to look at AVCGI as a very serious career option for your future. best wishes and thank you once again.
Thank you very much. Indeed, a pleasure, and thanks for inspiring our students to move into this industry also. All the experts had actually been talking about it, and thanks for talking about how Government of India and Government of Telangana is going to encourage it. And surely, sir, we, in fact, as Swaga representatives, we have Rajiv and Mike as part of this panel also. And we would definitely work with Swaga and come out with this book in the, you know, probably in about a fortnight, and try to reach it out to the colleges so that they can be more aware of it. The kind of discussions that have happened within the panel itself have been really very, very encouraging. And the options that have been spoken about are, I think a lot of students would benefit from it, sir. Thank you very much for your presence and taking out time. So before we conclude, probably we would also look at the students, since they have put some questions over here. We would ask those questions. So Junaid Syed is saying, how could you change the people's mindset, especially parents, to let the kin opt these progressive skill-based and job-oriented creative visual art courses for more specifically at graduation level? Rajesh, if you would like to answer that.
Yes, this exercise I started in the year 2000, where it has been a hard task because parents want the kids to have some kind of a formal degree which is recognized, make them more marriageable, you know, eligible for marriage and things like that. So, but we had a lot of seminars and webinars in local cities where the local heroes came in. So if somebody's worked on, say, a Bahubali, I would bring him to Hyderabad and I would make him do a seminar. And then we say, I'm from Hyderabad, I've done this and I've made a career out of this. And that way the parents were, you know, getting, realizing that this is a serious career, not just comics or just not just Tom and Jerry, but it's everything included, you know, and it's a great sphere in education. So they get that degree. If they get a degree in this, this will be very, very good. Or if they get a formal education with a certification diploma, it will be valuable and that they will be gainfully employed. That's what the parents are worried about. And that's what we had to do. So a lot of webinars and seminars, which we need to do to make parents like this one, to make parents understand that there is a lot of work and a lot of, it's a serious job, not comics. You know, it's a lot of serious work.
Right. Mike, would you like to add anything to it? Okay, I think there's some technology problem with Mike. Vivek KS asks, I'm a recent passed out of mechanical student with good CAD-CAM knowledge, almost 2 years spent in this. Do I have an opportunities in your field? Can I get internships in any of your firms or my skill sets? So Biren, if you could start and then I'll move to the to Rajiv and Mike. Biren, you're on mute.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
First of all, I'll come to this question in 1 second. I just wanted to thank Jayesh Ji for being continuously inspirational. I don't remember, Jayesh Ji, which time you took up your portfolio, but we corresponded in June and July of 2015 and made appointments to see each other. Finally, I could get to Hyderabad on the 3rd of August 2015. Jayesh Ji very patiently had an office with brimming with a lot of people. He sat on the sitting area there and he talked about 5 or 7 points of the industry, and I thought I had burdened him with a lot of questions and a lot of conversation. And the next day we were on another event together with you know, KT Ramarao Gadu on something else, and he said, I'll get back to you today. I happened to be sitting up in my hotel quite late that night. At 23:57, I got a long letter from Jayesh the same evening. Why I'm saying this on such a big call is that if you want to know a government that can work in real time with you, there are very few leaders and there are very few governments that have the capability of Jayesh Ji and his team and all of you on the call, you know, Amar, Shrikant, all of you. But I think, you know, normally the industry goes knocking on government doors and waits for a long time. And I am so proud of the work that, you know, Rajiv and Mike and others have done at Twaga. I think we all sat together, Jayesh Ji, to form the policy in a meeting. You had allowed us to call people from all over the country. And though Rajesh and I are not in Telangana, you can count us as also being part of your team and helping Paga and you. And it won't take long before we can get Rajesh and myself to also be there and doing things locally with you. So I just wanted to start on that note with all of you on that front. Yes. And Rajesh and I have already spoken about a few ideas on that, which we'll come to you separately on, sir. So with that, I will just answer the question as I did before to the gentleman who has finished 2 years and wants to look at it. If you have, if you believe you have a visual sense, which can be tested very easily, if you believe you have an interest in storytelling or using even imagery and simulation combined with your engineering skills, there are opportunities in all of the AVGC industry and beyond, as we talked about it earlier. When I walk into the R&D of Mercedes-Benz or Dassault Systems, which is very close to my studio, I walk in there and I feel like I've entered my own studio. Because when we create aircraft that lands on water in visual effects, you know, in Sully, and when I see them, they're creating things for Airbus, for real aircraft, the process of the CG and the animation and the imagery and the simulation is the same. It is being done for two different applications. So there is no need to think that your engineering track and your discipline there is far away from what you can do here. I think, you know, Rajiv said very clearly as to the fact that this industry is the perfect crossroad between the arts and the sciences. And all of the sciences have basically watched nature and created science. And now this industry is looking at science and using it to recreate nature in a simulated and in imagery. That is what visual effects is. And he talked about, I think Rajiv spoke about, you know, reflections, water, clouds, you know, and all of those. So please, I think if you were to reflect back on the seminar, I think you should be able to figure out that, you know, the basics are universal. The applications are bespoke. And I think it's a great idea from JSG that a playbook can be created by the industry that actually puts down this cross section between skill sets, aptitude, and I think that can become a very good primer for and it should be online also. It should be translated maybe into the local language in Telugu, etc., and can really be a great way for us to inform faculty in all the colleges that are on this call. I think they are as important as the students. Because the faculty is the guide. You know, Rajesh talked about the centers that he has and he talked about a role called the counselor. I think that is the responsibility of every teacher, of every principal, of every faculty member. I'm sure TASC is on that to also help and guide and channelize people into their sweet spot. So I will end with that and leave it for the next question.
Sure. Thanks, Biren. Moving on to Rajiv and Mike regarding the internship opportunities.
Yeah, I think I'll take that. So in this particular case, I think this guy is a mechanical student with knowledge of CAD/CAM, which actually is kind of lays the foundation to the animation field, because in this case, he already understands drawing, he already understands design. And now in half of what happens in the animation or even in gaming is the basically the buildings, the city, the house. So the first what is created is a design, a layout, and I think CAD similar thing happens, and you are basically extracting those designs into becoming structures. So I think that's a great foundation. I think what he would need is kind of a finishing school or somewhere, someone where he can, the 3-month course, learn somewhere. It could be done online in this times. And if he comes up with that, with some basic knowledge he already learns, I think a company like Green Gold would be happy to give internship to somebody with the basic skills, as well as the very fact that they're attending this seminar. It means that they're passionate about this field. And we would love to encourage that, not just to this person, but anyone who are interested in doing internship once, I think, the COVID scenario is out. I think in office, we would be happy to take internships for anyone who's got interest or a passion towards this field.
Sure. Yeah. Thanks, Mike.
Yeah, we at Rotomaker give internships for a lot of artists. We have internships for 6 months to 1 year. So if they complete any course from any school, any like Arena Animation or Automaker or Mac, we again take up and give 6 months internship. We pay them and we train them and we teach them the Hollywood standards, how to make the visual effects for the Hollywood movies. And we again then hire them. So we are always welcome throughout the year internships. We need a lot of artists. Next year, we are almost hiring close to 1,000 people. So we're looking very much for the students who have completed the courses. Yeah.
Very nice. Thank you. Dipti, your question has been practically answered by Jayesh Garu, which is what is the scope of game designing in India and the job security for especially for women? However, in case someone else would like to add a point there.
Okay. Just wanted to say we have 600 people in gaming, close to 800 during the peak periods of the year. The producer that runs our entire team is a woman, is a lady. And we have generally found, I apologize to all the male folk on this call, that we have found that the productivity of the women in our studio is higher than that of the men. We have not analyzed why, but it is genuinely true. It is also true both for our country, I'm sure also for the state and also for our industry, that the biggest latent power that we have is women coming into the workforce. And this is a fantastic industry for them. It's a clean industry. It's a knowledge industry. It is, it is a studio-based industry. This problem is worldwide. I am not sure of the real number. I have two people from the education field on the, Mike and Rajesh. The percentage of women that actually go to train and learn animation, visual effects and games is far, far, far higher than those that come and stay in the workforce. This is an inexplicable thing on my part. Maybe 20-30% of people come for training out of the whole. But the national average for women in animation, visual effects and games is less than 1.5%. I have made this a campaign every 8th of March. I am in the room. And we have grown in our team from 200 people. Now we are 11% out of the 5,500 people are women. And we are completely dissatisfied with that. And I'm sure that all of us who are in the industry should do a lot more, because this is a fantastic opportunity for the development of not only the balance of genders, but also for our industry to have be more productive in the local and national and international scene.
Great. Anu is asking, I've completed my BTech from ECE. Can I get into animation? Yes. Where should I begin? I think we have already discussed that. So in the interest of time, I'm not going into all the questions, and probably we will respond to some of the questions later on. Rajita is asking, what are the skills and qualities you're looking for freshers to recruit? Apart from the skills that are discussed, probably personality skills or something like that. And what could be the starting packages, though we said that, best amongst the industry, but in case someone would like to take a shot at this piece?
Yeah, I think I can take that. So for us, the average salary in the company is about 48,000 rupees. That's the average of my entire company. And there are different people at different pay scales. Usually, the freshers start anywhere between 20 to 30,000 rupees a month, and basically depending on their background and stuff. So depending, sometimes freshers also start around 50,000, but that is rare, and that is somebody who is highly accomplished. Otherwise, usually the starting pay package is between 20 to 30,000 a month.
Okay, thanks. One good question is, how can education institutions introduce a course to students from year one? So I think we have discussed it, and we have made points where we said that, painting and art should be introduced in schools itself to bring it up. A question by Tapti Priya. Sir, as you would have, you told us 2 years to complete training, but I want to know that if I'm passionate about the field or not. So what is the best affordable way of getting into the gaming and animation in field, and also check my interest in it? Rajesh?
Okay. Basically, you should call one of our centers and get counsel first, and then the counselor will actually guide you as to what kind of course you can take. We can give you an online trial class just as a freebie, no problem. And then if you like that thing, then you can enroll for a short program and then go further. So you just online, if you look up our website Framebox, you'll get our head office number. Please get counseled by somebody there, and then we can take this forward. I will put someone onto this when I get back to office.
Great. Thank you very much. I think we have already shot over time. It's all we didn't even realize more than 2 hours have passed since we have been into this session. It's already 5:22. So whatever questions are left, probably we'll reach out to the panelists and answer them and each one individually later on. And of course, we'll also be putting up the recording of this webinar also up on the task as well, YouTube channel as well as the task portal also. So I think I would like to thank Jayashandran sir first of all for for his presence on this call, and that only goes to show the commitment that the government of Telangana has for the students, the youth, the colleges, the entire ecosystem, as well as the animation industry, gaming industry, and how we as Telangana as a state is interested in becoming the number one. So Biren, sorry about that. Bangalore may be moving out, and Hyderabad might become number one.
So I already clarified. I will take some credit for that, and I don't be surprised if you find me there.
Great. And on that note, Biren, I think I would like to thank you not only for being on this panel, but thank you very much for also helping put this panel together. You know, in such a short time when we discussed this idea that we would like to do such a thing, thank you very much for, helping us out and putting this panel together and helping our youth understand the various opportunities that would open up for them. They are there and would open up for them. Shortly in Telangana also.
I wanted to look good by finding three panelists from the industry who are better than me, so I did my job.
Thanks, Biren. Rajiv, thank you very much for coming on board, and all the very best. And I'm sure that a lot of people, are looking at all of you to make a beeline to your organization and your website. Today, if you get innumerable number of hits, then you know whom to blame and the way to look out for. And as we said, we would be taking this discussion forward, and as Twaga, we would be coming up with this booklet very, very soon. So I would connect up with you offline and post this webinar, but thank you very much for being on it and sharing your thoughts.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Before I conclude, sir, I'd like to say that all the participants to take the poll first.
Let them take the poll while I'm thanking everyone. So you can put the poll questions, Shiva. Rajesh would like to thank you for bringing in the angle that you did from both sides of the table, the side of running a studio as well as running an education institution yourself now, and what would be the skills, and helping us understand how TASC could begin this journey along in partnership with all of you here in ensuring that we are able to provide all the people who come to Hyderabad and Telangana as part of this ecosystem which Amar will bring, get the right kind of talent and manpower. On that note, Amar, I'd like to thank you also for being part of this panel and bringing in the perspective of the state, as well as talking about the image tower and all the work that the department is doing, and how we can actually make this ecosystem a much more robust ecosystem and actually start offering programs. Because as of now, TASC is not offering any programs. So here is a commitment to all over here that we will surely start offering programs soon. In fact, myself and Biren and others have been in conversation earlier also, and we will bring it to closure very soon. And we would be starting to offer programs on through TASC platform also. Mike, as usual, you are hiding yourself, probably being shy, but the job that you did today on this panel, thank you very much for bringing in your unique perspective, as well as helping us understand how the VFX industry has really changed and how everyone can become, even the engineering students, etc., can become part of the VFX industry, as well as the potential. And thank you for saying 1,000 people are required by you next year. I'm counting on it, and we'd be happy. TASC would be happy to do a pre-selection, work with you very closely, and you know, provide you with a first-day, first-hour productivity program where we would mutually build a curriculum together and you know, get you the right kind of people after doing pre-assessments as well as training them jointly. And that's the offer that I would like to make to everyone over here, that the government of Telangana through TASC would be happy to provide you with the first day, first hour productive manpower when you start your operations or in your existing operations. So Biren, you can take me up on that when you start here in Telangana. On that note, thank you very much. It's already 5:28. So Shiva, in case the bold results are in, then you could display them. Otherwise, over to you for concluding the session.
Yes, yes, sir. Thank you very much. Well, that was a very informative, interesting, and an excellent discussion. First of all, again, I'd like to take this opportunity to thank our Principal Secretary, Shri Jayashanjan Garu, Government of Telangana. Thank you very much, sir. It was great. It was a great honor having you here in this discussion, as part of this discussion. And I also thank each and every member of the panel. Each and every one of you have added a great value to the discussion today. I personally have enjoyed this discussion, like from the creators of Chota Beam, DreamWorks, our ex-CEO, and other panel members, and this can't be any better. And I believe all our participants also had a great time hearing to you all. And for the students out there, you have heard all of them say that there are lots of opportunities out there, and TASC as an organization also will look into how we can get them closer to you. There are about 11.4 lakh people that are needed for by the end of 2022, as entertainment is not a necessity, but not a, is a necessity, but not a luxury. So it's going to be there and present all the time. And we've also heard about all the infrastructure that is coming up in Hyderabad, where the right talent is required, and also in the tier two cities as well. So as also Jayashanjan sir said, that this industry is going to stand in the long run. Only thing is that you have to be very practical and passionate about it. So the one takeaway that I want to give all the students is that you have to keep yourself upgraded, be strong with the basics, and a great job should not be the focus, but learning and improvement in the job you have should be the prime focus. You should be also as self-made, because your work shows up here and you cannot fool around here. One need to be passionate and creative enough to withstand this industry. Thank you very much, one and all. It was a great pleasure having you all here. It's a great honor as well. So coming to the poll results, we have posted a question saying, did this webinar answer the question you had about career prospectus in this industry? 92% of them said yes, and 7% said no. How relevant was the discussion to your current requirement about your career? 52% said yes, 39% has said relevant, and 52 said very relevant. So I think this discussion was very, very productive and definitely reached all the students and the college fraternity. Thank you very much, one and all. Thank you.
Just for the college principals, students, etc., we will be there next week, Thursday 27th. With expectations of the food processing industry post-COVID. So yes, we'll see you there. Thank you very much, everyone.